Thank you. It's great to be here. My mother was visited by voices. They arrived in the last months of her life as she ventured ever further from lucidity. She had no musical background, she had no training, she wasn't even particularly in love with music. Colluding with hearing loss, the void created by her dementia seemed to be filled by imagined sound. Sometimes welcome, more often not, these visitations were vivid yet segmented and tattered. She would occasionally comment on the singer, Mitch Miller, whose depressingly cheerful arrangements of popular songs used to send me running from the room as a kid. But in her last days, she shared her musical hallucinations by spontaneously humming wordless, vague fragments of melody. The great 12th century mystic composer, Hildegard von Bingen, transcribed her auditory hallucinations, one of which we just heard. "I heard the voice from heaven speak to me," she wrote in her collection of visions, Shivyas. And so, I decided to transcribe what my mother's was humming. A number of recurrent melodic patterns emerged. Most of the fragments contained a small rising interval followed by an upwards leap. Here are patterns that I transcribed on December 10th, 2009. And fragments that I transcribed just 2 days later. So these patterns were strikingly consistent, and there was a similarity between them. It was almost as if my mom was struggling to recall a song, or perhaps she had one stuck in her head. I wasn't sure whether this was a case of musical lethologica or an earworm. A few days later, I accompanied my mom to the hospital. It was the last time she would leave her house, and in the hospital lobby, a volunteer harpist was playing insipid arrangements of Christmas songs. As I wheeled my mom inside, she looked up from the gurney and with glistening eyes exclaimed, "Isn't it beautiful?" I struggled to find an answer that wasn't snarky, but then she added, "I just love his voice." And I suddenly realized she was not referring to the butchered holiday music, but rather to something entirely different, something only she could hear. And foolishly, I responded, "Mom, there's no singer, it's in your head," a response I regret to this day. Soon after she died, I searched for the song that obsessed her, and with a combination of many hunches and a good deal of luck, I found this. So if you note the pattern of the salient phrase, the river, compared to my mother's vocalizations, I'll play that snippet and then my mother's, the transcription of what my mother sang.
The river.
And my mother's. And then the same step leap in the words, waiting for the moon.
Waiting for the moon.
So out of all the music she may have heard throughout her life, how is it that she recalled this song? By that point, my mother didn't recognize me. She didn't know who my brother was. And yet she was enjoying a seemingly random, mediocre, popular song. Mediocre, perhaps, but not random. Composed in 1946, Cruisin' Down the River found its way to the top of the popular music charts the very week my brother was born. Soon after my mother died, I tried to portray the song emerging from her clouded and tattered memory in a piano trio I wrote called Memory Slips. Here's an excerpt of that moment. My mother's sensorially deprived world was an incubator and a breeding ground for her musical hallucinations, an auditory analogy to Charles Bonnet syndrome. Suffering from severe manic depression, the composer Robert Schumann, also isolated and sensorially deprived in his last days, believed that the very last melody that he wrote was transmitted to him by Franz Schubert, who had died 50 years earlier. But confronted by noise and chaotic sound, we often also hear voices. On subway platforms or as jets fly over, people often imagine their name being called or their mobile phones ring. Leonardo da Vinci pointed out that the perceptual confusion caused by the noise of a church bell, whose complex frequency spectrum makes it impossible to unambiguously distinguish a particular tone, in whose jangle, he wrote, you may find any name or word you choose to imagine. So perhaps this is what George Bernard Shaw meant when his Joan of Arc in St. Joan said, "It is in the bells that I hear my voices." Last week, I saw the Vienna Opera production of Verdi's Macbeth, in which, of course, hallucinations is central. I was struck by Verdi's depiction of Macbeth's inner voice, a radical departure from how Shakespeare described them. Here, Macbeth describes the act of hallucinating with terror, and yet when he actually describes the depiction of his hallucination, it's with an unsettling tranquility, even momentary delight. And here's his description. So Macbeth's calmness and even enjoyment is reminiscent of my mother's momentary delight in the voices that she heard. And that momentary melodic delight here, since last week, has buried its way into my musical consciousness and is now constantly plaguing me as an earworm. Pleasure has turned to torture. On March 16, 1968, a very young Army helicopter pilot named Hugh Thompson witnessed and attempted to prevent one of the most horrific war crimes in American history. My opera, Milai, portrays Thompson in the last days of his life, dying from cancer, reliving the nightmare after decades of being ostracized and called a traitor for his refusal to remain silent. Here, Thompson's inner struggle spurs a confusion between external and inner voices.
Mary, can you hear me? Over, 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 over.
From Idaho, a nurse from Maine, and a chief warrant officer in our armed forces, a helicopter pilot. Am I right, sir? All right, then. You know how the game is played. We'll show you three doors, a red, a white, and a blue one. Choose one, and the game is on. And to honor our brave American troops, let's start with you, officer. I'm sure you've had to make some difficult choices in your line of work. This one should be a piece of cake. So, officer, which will it be? Blue, white, or red? Our officer seems a bit lost, but he is a helicopter pilot, folks. I'm sure he knows how to land this thing. So, what'll it be, Captain?
Are you talking to me?
I said, what'll it be, Captain?
I'm not a captain.
Hey, that woke him up. Always important to get the right rank. Sir, yes, sir! But seriously, Officer Thompson, time's running out. Make your choice.
All the doors are red.
Look again, officer.
No, the doors are all red.
At last. Our contestant has chosen the red door.
No, no, that's not what I said. Now, for Christ's sake, I never said that. I never chose that.
Let's open the door and see what's behind it.
Wait, now, hang on.
Here we go.
Hang on.
Oh, too late to change your mind, Chief. Phil, what has the officer chosen?
Well, Dick, the smoke is clearing. Just make it out now. Okay, looks like a ditch full of bodies. Old people, women and children. Yeah, I see it now. Women and children, babies, all dead or about to be, Dick.
You stop this right now!
Can we stop it, folks? This is how the game is played!
You stop this right now!
Candy ass, bleeding heart, motherfucker!
Last story. My brother-in-law suffers from schizophrenia, which manifests itself in obsessive repetitions of bizarre religious ritual incantations. At times he would demand that I incessantly repeat a concocted blessing over and over and over again. He would stop anyone in the street he encountered and demand that they recite these blessings. He was often under the spell of voices within. Soon after his mother died, we took him to visit her grave, and for a very brief and incredibly poignant moment, he seemed to break through these inner voices and said, "I caused her great pain." And then he returned immediately to his compulsive behavior. Deeply moved by this, I teamed up with poet Dan O'Brien to write an opera called Theotokia about an individual with delusional schizophrenia enslaved by strange religious rituals. In Theotokia, the audience becomes privy to the inner voices of the protagonist, Leon. And in this excerpt, the voice of a violent godmother who lives in an imaginary cave in the Himalayas combines glossolalia with bizarre incantations. Those of you who are versed in the literature on schizophrenia, you might notice the influence of Milton Rokic's Three Christs of Ypsilanti, from which we borrowed. Inspired by my brother-in-law's poignant moment of clarity, Theotokia ends with Leon's momentary distinction between the real and the imagined. For a moment, he concedes that there is no Himalayan Mother of God. There is no cave. I'm going to end my presentation with the final 3 minutes of Theotokia and say thank you in advance.
Thank you.